Whether you're watching this video on a laptop, a desktop, a smartphone, maybe even a smart TV, you're watching it on some kind of computer. Computers are all around us, but how many of us actually understand how they work? I know. Too complicated, right? Well, maybe not. By the end of this video, I'm gonna have explained how all the computers we use are built around just two different types of microchips, and maybe we'll see that they're not all that complicated after all. So I designed and built this 8-bit retro console myself. It's made almost entirely out of parts that anyone can find online, and it really plays games designed for the Sega Master System from the 1980s. If you think you might like to build one yourself, I'm going to post a link at the end of the video about how you can get involved in the crowdfunding campaign. So this chip right here is the brains of the operation. It's a Zilog Z80 Central Processing Unit, or CPU. So CPUs are an example of what most of us call microchips, but the technical term is integrated circuits, or ICs for short. And the job of a CPU is simply to carry out instructions that we tell it to. Now the Z80 CPU that I'm using was launched in 1976. It's historically very interesting, and it still has some applications today, but it's not exactly cutting edge technology. The way in which CPUs are designed hasn't really changed that much in the last 50 years. From PCs to Macs, consoles to cache machines, iPhones to Androids, all of them are based around CPUs. The basic idea is that each CPU has a fixed set of instructions that it understands how to carry out. We call that the instruction set of the CPU. Makes sense, right? For instance, the Z80 CPU that I showed you earlier supports around 158 different types of instructions. And if I've done my job editing properly, you should see them rolling up the screen about now. So let's say we've managed to get ourselves a CPU. How do we take that and build a computer out of it? Now this might come as a surprise, but much like your air fryer, all electronic components come with an instruction manual called a datasheet. And the instruction manual for the Z80 lists all the instructions that it supports and how they work. Right, so we've got the datasheet for the Z80 open here. This page, for example, tells us about the pins and what each one does. Here's where the section starts, which lists the instruction set of the CPU. And you can scroll down and see all the instructions. For example, this instruction here adds two numbers together. Now I'd like to see your air fryer do that. I mean, I'm just saying, they're just tiny ovens. Wake up, people. Different CPUs by different manufacturers have different instruction sets. Imagine, if you like, that each CPU has its own native language that only it understands. It's one of the reasons why a program written for a PC, for example, won't work if you try and copy it to an iPhone. The CPU inside the iPhone doesn't understand the instruction set that the PC program was written for. So if CPUs sound really clever, well they are, but they're not quite enough to make a computer. On their own, they're kind of useless. To make a really useful computer, we need to pair our CPU up with another chip. CPU, meet memory. Memory has one simple job, to store information so we can recall it later. So here's my retro computer again, and there are three types of memory here I'd like to talk about. These two chips here are what we call registers, this one over here is a RAM, and this one right here is what we call a ROM. The most basic type of memory we can imagine is called a flip-flop, not to be confused with those shoes you wear on the beach. A flip-flop is a device with an input for incoming data, an output, and a second input, which is used to control whether or not the flip-flop should store data or not. The input takes a single binary value, which means it can either be 1 or 0, and under normal circumstances it can change between 1 and 0, but the output stays the same. However, when we activate the control input, whatever value happens to be at the input at that time is stored inside the flip-flop and the output changes to reflect it. After that, even if the input changes again, the stored value stays at the output. The value stored is remembered until the next time the control input changes. We can stack up more than one flip-flop, and if we share all the control inputs together, we end up with something called a register, which is really just a flip-flop that can store more than one digital value at a time. We call each individual binary value a bit, and when we're designing registers, we usually build them to store multiples of 8 bits at a time. Storing 8 bits is so common that we gave that a name too, which you've probably heard of, a byte. So this chip right here is a 74HCT273, and this one is made by Texas Instruments. I don't know if you can see the logo right there, but it's an example of something called standard logic, which means that lots of different manufacturers make the same chip. So the 273 is an 8-bit register, an 8-way flip-flop, just like we were talking about. And I used two of them in my retro console. Now, being able to store just one byte might be enough for some purposes, but for most computers that want to do anything useful, it's nowhere near enough. Modern computers can store billions of bytes at the same time. If we could put lots of registers into a single chip, we'd end up with something called a RAM, or random access memory. So going back to our 74273 register again, this chip can store 1 byte of information, but it takes 20 pins to do that. So if we're going to be able to store millions or billions of bytes in our RAM, we're going to have to come up with a better system for arranging the pins. Our 8-bit register chip lets us read a byte at the same time as we're writing it, but if we're okay making the compromise that we can only read or write a byte at the same time, then we can save 8 pins. We can combine the 8 input pins with the 8 output pins by making them bidirectional, so that they become input-output or I/O pins. We'll also need to add 2 control pins, which we'll use to set the direction of the I/O pins. If the read pin is active, the I/O pins will output the byte that's being stored, and if the write pins are active, they'll receive a new byte to be stored. But we're still only storing 1 byte. If we wanted to store 2 bytes and not use any more I/O pins, can use a technique called multiplexing. We'll add another control pin called A0, and we'll make it so that when A0 is 0, the I/O pins will be reading from or writing to the first of our 2 bytes, and when A0 is 1, they'll be accessing the second byte. If we add a second pin, A1, we'll find that we can address not 2, but 4 bytes, one for each of the combinations of A1 and A0 that's possible. That's 00, 01, 10 and 11. Adding a third pin lets us address not 4 but 8 bytes, and so on. Every time we add a new A pin, we double the number of memory locations we can address. We call these different memory locations addresses, and so we call the group of pins which are used to select the address the address pins. We call the 8 I/O pins which read or write the data values the data pins. And that's how you make a RAM. Okay, let's test how much we know about RAMs by playing a game. How big is your RAM? This chip I've got here is the AS6C4008 static RAM from a company called Alliance. The first thing we need to do to figure out how much it can store is to count the address pins. Every time we count a pin, we're going to double the number of address locations. Our chip has 19 address pins, which means it has a total of 524,288 address locations. Now let's count the data pins. There are 8 of those, which means that each memory location can store 1 byte. To keep the numbers a bit easy to manage, let's also call 1024 bytes a kilobyte, which means that the total capacity of our chip is 524,288 bytes, or 512 kilobytes. Do you remember the third type of memory I showed you in my computer? That was a ROM, which stands for read-only memory. ROMs have data and address pins just like RAM, but as the name suggests, you can only read data from a ROM, you can't write or update it. This means that ROMs usually have their data stored on them in the manufacturing process, and later we're going to see 2 reasons why that might be useful. Another difference between RAMs and ROMs is that when you take away the power supply to a RAM, it usually forgets everything that it knows. ROMs, on the other hand, keep their data intact even when they're not powered up. Anyway, of the 3 types of memory we've talked about, it's RAM that's the most important in a computer, and to understand why, we're going to have to go back in time to the 1930s and do a little bit of background theory. Just a little bit. This was before digital electronics as we know it even existed. A group of mathematicians was working on ways to understand the maths of problem solving. 2 of the most prominent were Alan Turing and Alonzo Church, and together they came up with a definition called the Turing-Church thesis, which proposes that any problem which can be solved by what we call an algorithm, that's a finite series of well-defined steps, must be solvable by a simple hypothetical device called a Turing machine. The Turing machine can be imagined as a box with a paper tape running through it. The box has a set of rules baked into it, which allow it to read symbols from the tape and make decisions based on the symbols that it reads. Using these rules, it can either choose to move the tape forwards or backwards, overwrite some of the symbols on the tape, or just stop running completely once the job is finished. Now we can design a Turing machine to solve one specific problem, like adding 2 numbers together, but we can also design a Turing machine to simulate any other Turing machine based on symbols that it reads from the tape. A Turing machine which is capable of simulating any other Turing machine is called a universal Turing machine. And by definition, it's able to solve any problem that any Turing machine can solve, which, according to the Turing-Church thesis, is any algorithmic problem. Now, I don't know about you, but I just find it mind-blowing to think that an idea as simple as a box with a paper tape running through it is capable of solving so many complex problems. But it really does work, and modern computers are the proof of that. Of course, there are 2 parts to the Turing machine. There's the box and there's the tape. You probably already guessed that the CPU with its instruction set is the electronic equivalent of the box, but what about the tape? Well, that's where the RAM comes in. RAM lets us read, store, and overwrite values, just like the tape in the Turing machine. And that's why RAM is so critical in a computer. As I always say, a computer without RAM is like a Turing machine without a tape.
What?
What? I do say that. It's funny. Now, in theory, a universal Turing machine actually needs a tape that's infinitely long. But infinite memory doesn't exist. How much of a problem is this? Well, we might technically need an infinite amount of memory to make a universal Turing machine, but it turns out that in practice we can solve most of the problems that we need to with computers with a finite amount of memory. Generally speaking though, bigger is better. I'm talking about memory here. Jeez, get your mind out the gutter. Okay, so now we've got all the theory sorted, let's have a look at how you take a CPU and a RAM and connect them together in real life to make them do something. Remember we said that RAM chips have address pins to select which byte we're interested in, and data pins to send and receive those bytes? Well, the CPU also has address and data pins to match. The Z80, for example, has 16 address pins and 8 data pins, and it also has read and write pins just like the RAM does. Together these make up over half of the 40 pins that the Z80 has in total. We can wire up the 16 address pins on the CPU to 16 of the address pins on the RAM, and we can do the same with the data pins. We can also connect the read and write pins of the CPU and the RAM together. Now that the address pins of both devices are connected together, we call the group of wires connecting them the address bus. Similarly, we call the group of wires connecting the 8 data pins of each device the data bus. Having connected the CPU to memory like this, it's now able to manipulate the address bus, the data bus, and the control wires to write data to or read data from memory, if that's something that we tell it to do. It's even possible to connect more than 2 devices to the buses so that the CPU can talk to many different memories or even peripherals like keyboards or displays. More on this later. One important thing to note here is that because the Z80 has 16 address pins, we can only address up to 64 kilobytes of memory at one time. We say that the Z80 has a 64 kilobyte address space. Okay, great, so now the CPU is connected to RAM and it can read from it or write to it whenever we tell it to. But how do we tell the CPU to do stuff? And how does it actually do the things that we tell it to? Remember the registers from earlier? Well, pretty much all CPUs are made with registers inside them, and ours is no exception. The number and purpose of registers varies a lot from CPU to CPU, but the Z80 has something like 16 general purpose registers, most of which can either store 8 or 16 bits at a time. The registers are important for temporarily holding data for use in calculations. For example, let's imagine that register A has the number 3 stored in it, and register B has the number 4 stored in it. One of the instructions the Z80 understands is add B to A, and when it receives this instruction, it adds those two numbers together and stores the result back into register A. Now, addition is an example of an instruction which only uses internal registers, but some of the instructions that CPUs understand allow them to load values from external memory into the internal registers, and vice versa. For example, this instruction loads a byte from memory address 5 and stores it into register A. Here are 4 more instructions we can tack onto that last one, which together have the effect of loading 2 values from memory, adding them together, and storing the result back to memory again. Feel free to rewind the video and slow it down if you want to follow all the steps here. We call this sequence of instructions a program, and whenever you use a computer to play a game, write a document, compose a tweet, or even write your own programs, under the hood, the CPU is just executing sequences of instructions like this from its instruction set, albeit millions or even billions of times every second. Okay, so now we've seen some examples of CPUs running instructions. The next question to answer is, how do we feed those instructions into the CPU in the first place? Because the CPU already knows how to read things from memory, why don't we store the instructions that we want it to run in memory too? We need to make some kind of convention around how the CPU reads programs from memory. One of the simplest ways is what the Z80 does. When you first turn it on, it reads a byte from memory address 0, that's the first memory address, into a special register called the instruction register. This is called an instruction fetch. The next thing it needs to do is decode the byte that it's just read. Each instruction that the CPU understands is encoded as a unique sequence of ones and zeros that, again, we can look up in the datasheet. For example, the add AB instruction that we saw earlier in the Z80 is encoded as 1000000. So whenever the CPU sees that specific sequence of ones and zeros read into an instruction, it knows that it has to perform the add operation. Some instructions need to be encoded into more than one byte, and in that situation, the CPU will keep reading bytes from memory until it's decoded an entire instruction. Now, you may have heard people refer to computer programs as code. Well, these instruction encodings are like the original code. They're actually called machine code, and they're the only programming language that computers really understand. Then the CPU will execute the instruction, which is just a fancy way of saying that it runs it. After each instruction is finished executing, the CPU then starts the next fetch, reading a new instruction from the next address down in memory. This fetch, decode, execute cycle continues indefinitely until either the CPU receives an instruction to stop or until someone turns the power off. Now, usually instructions are run one after the other like this, but an important class of instructions that all CPUs support are so-called jump instructions, which can be used to break that normal convention of instructions running in order. Jump instructions can be used to tell the CPU to look in a completely different part of memory for the next instruction to run, even in places where it's already executed instructions from. An instruction which only jumps under certain conditions is called a conditional jump or conditional branch instruction. And it turns out that if a CPU has a conditional branch instruction, it's automatically powerful enough to be a universal Turing machine, which is why almost every CPU has one in its instruction set. It's very common to see programs where the CPU conditionally branches back to a point it's already been to. For example, we might want to repeat a certain block of instructions until some register counts down to zero. This example here does exactly that in order to add all the numbers from 5 to 1 together and get the result. We call this type of programming technique a loop. As we've already seen, some of the instructions that CPUs understand allow them to read values from or write values to memory. So it's important to remember that there are now two reasons CPUs have to read from memory. They do it automatically whenever a new instruction needs to be fetched from memory, and they might do it sometimes whenever the instruction they're currently executing is one that requires a memory read. We say that computers which use the same memory to store both instructions and data have a von Neumann or sometimes Princeton architecture. This is very similar to the original idea of the Turing machine, with the CPU as the box and the memory as the tape. The Z80 is an example of a von Neumann machine. Because the bytes storing instructions and data are essentially indistinguishable in memory, programmers usually work with memory models which keep them separate and organized. Some computers have completely separate address and data buses and store their programs in completely separate memories from other data. These are called Harvard architectures. Okay, so now that we've seen how computers store their programs in memory and how the CPU will run that program from memory when it's powered up, you might think there's a bit of a chicken and egg problem here. How is it that we get the program into memory in the first place so that the CPU can find it? If you're old enough to remember games consoles with cartridges, these used a really simple technique. They were designed with a gap in the memory space. Remember, the Z80 has 16 address pins, so it has a 64 kilobyte address space. The computer I built, much like the Sega Master System which inspired it, has some RAM from address 48K onwards, but nothing at all from address 0. A bit of a problem if we turn the console on without any cartridge inserted. If we take a cartridge apart, we'll see that it has a ROM chip inside it. And this ROM has got all the game instructions pre-programmed into it. The data and address pins of the ROM are connected to the metal contacts on the edge of the cartridge. There's a socket inside the console which receives a cartridge, and this is connected to the main address and data buses of the CPU. When we plug the cartridge in, making sure the power's off first, it completes the connection between the ROM and the address and data buses, perfectly filling that gap in the address space. Finally, when we turn the power on, the CPU boots and starts fetching instructions from memory address 0 on the cartridge ROM, and our game starts running. So unfortunately for us nostalgia nerds, we don't use cartridges so much these days. We expect our CPUs to be able to do something useful as soon as we turn them on, without having to plug anything in. A solution that works better for general purpose computers is to embed a ROM into the computer at memory address 0, and to put a program on that ROM whose job it is to look for other programs to run, usually on a hard disk. On most computers, this ROM program tries to find some kind of operating system to hand over to. These built-in ROM programs are called BIOSes, which stands for Basic Input Output System. And because they sit somewhere between hardware and software, we often say that they're examples of firmware. Because BIOS programs are quite basic, it means that the ROM that contains them doesn't need to be all that big, giving us more space in our computer for RAM compared with the cartridge method. So one thing we haven't covered yet is how computers talk to the outside world. Devices that CPUs can talk to, which aren't memory, are called peripherals, and there are just tons of ways that communication can happen, so we're going to have to revisit that another time. Well, that's the end of this video. I hope you've enjoyed it. If you'd like to learn more about computers or computing, or if you'd like to build your own retro computer like I did, remember to like and subscribe and to sign up for our crowdfunding mailing list so you can get more information about how to get your own Retcon kit. Just go to www.undeveloper.com/retcon.